Hi, everyone. It's Plastic EP with Sabine. How are you, Sabine? We got a very special
VIP here we guest. Go.
Now, this man is a champion of the world, right? He comes in from every country, all over the universe. We love the guy. How are you today, Andrew Eborn?
I am incredibly well. It is so lovely to see you both again in spite of my campaign. More than 700 shows. How on earth have you done it? You're still surviving. You're still groovy. I love it.
We're still groovy.
Let me tell you, we're about 740 now already.
Yeah.
And you're feeling groovy.
I'm always feeling groovy. I feel more groovy.
Hey, bananas, we think you're groovy.
We think you're groovy.
Hey, bananas, we watch a movie.
Watch a movie, yeah.
Drive your tune buggies everywhere. Just going crazy without a care. Hey, bananas,
we think you're groovy.
Hey, bananas, we think you're groovy.
Andrew,
you're not good. Hey, look at that.
Yeah, that's the one.
That's the man.
Yeah, excellent. There we go.
Did you see I went from that pointing completely the wrong way?
Yeah.
To that.
Yeah.
Oh, come on. A season yeah. Ball.
There we
I
go. Yeah, here we go.
Get your copy. Get your copy now. Andrew Eborn's Book of Failure, rare, unsigned copy, but you can get yours on eBay, a special for Plastic EP, and we've got the modern edition at a special price. It's on eBay. So you'll share the link, won't you? To your
yeah, we'll share everything out.
We'll share the link. Get your copy now, and throwing it away, giving it away to all good causes. It's going to be good.
Can everybody go out and buy the book because we want to help Andrew to make it to Buckingham Palace.
I've been to Buckingham Palace.
Yeah. Yeah,
met Her Majesty, who is brilliant, and we're loving her, particularly this year, the 70th anniversary, the platinum jubilee. Can you believe it? And she's out and about. She's 96 years young, an incredible lady, and she's absolutely brilliant. Oh, look, Sabine's got one as well.
There's Yay. One. It's a fantastic read. Go out and get it.
What are you going to call Andrew? He had a special
Lord Eborn. We know him as Lord Eborn, don't we? And Mike Reed, Lord, you know, Lord, that's where I got it from. Our dear Mike Reed.
Mike, as you rightly say, he wrote the foreword to this
he
book.
Did and indeed
a foreword, and it's actually more than four words, but he wrote them all. And it's brilliant though. But Mike is a lovely broadcaster who is a national treasure here in the UK. And did you know him in Australia?
Who's that?
Oh, there you go, that's showbiz for you.
He needs to go to Australia as well.
Look at that, look at that one. That's The Art of Magic with Andrew Eborn. Now, that was the very first ever commercially released video. VHS, can you believe that format?
Wow. I still have video cassettes. I have loads of them.
And it taught people the secrets of magic. It's incredibly rare, and they're going for thousands, literally thousands of pounds now if you get your hand on a copy.
So, Andrew, tell us a little bit about the Magic Circle and your links with that. Because, I mean, where did your interest start in magic? Was it from childhood, from your father, or how did that all come about? And
I can tell you, my father was a magician. He disappeared when I was seven. Boom, tish.
Boom, boom.
I'm here all week. My interesting magic, actually, we had great magicians on the telly. When I was growing up, we had Paul Daniels, David Nixon.
Yeah.
But actually, one of my favorite was a guy who's actually a comedian called Tommy Cooper.
The guy with the Turkish hat.
With the fez.
And he was absolutely brilliant. And what I loved about it, he didn't do the taking it too seriously. It was all about the comedy. And the big mistake a lot of magicians make, a lot of performers actually, they just say, look, watch me, aren't I wonderful? As opposed to turning around, just take the audience on a journey. Just enjoy what you do. And Tommy was brilliant. So I used to sing and dance, can you believe it? But also perform and do comedy when I was a little kid. And a lot of our family, we've got quite a few people in the business, in the family. My aunt was somebody called Jill Ireland, who's a very famous actress.
Oh, yes.
Yeah, and she was married to Charles Bronson, you might remember, who did all the Death Wish movies. Mm-hmm. And she was also married There you go. I reveal all your secrets here on the Plastic EP show. And the other thing, she was also married to David McCullum, who was the handsome uncle, but also the invisible uncle. Man. The invisible man, but we never saw him.
Oh.
Yeah, but also the man from Uncle.
Exactly, he was the man from the Uncle. But the Uncle was my
Iliad
uncle.
Kiriaku.
That's the one. Oh, look at you. Very good.
Yeah. But no wonder you've got showbiz in your blood, Andrew.
Oh, I've got all sorts of things in my blood.
Yes.
Thank you, officer. It's got to be good. We work on that sort of basis. No, but that got something sort of interesting. But when you're a youngster, your family always want you to be something respectable. So,
yeah. Lawyer, doctor. Yeah.
Mm-hmm. And I worked out that basically you're an actor, but you write your own script when you're a lawyer. So I did all that, but I combined the professions and I'm now dealing with everything across the IP value chain, from the creation of ideas to basically production to holograms and putting on events and all sorts of glorious things and finding talent around the world. Yeah. And what I'm loving at the moment, we're appearing on more platforms than Paddington, as we say. But I'm doing lots of a regular show over here on some of our broadcasters, but they're all broadcast internationally now. They're almost as famous as the Plastic EP show.
But I got to say, growing up in the 60s, do you know how big the influence was of the UK and the Queen? I used to go to elementary school. At that point, we call it state school. But in America, they call them elementary school. And we had the picture of the Queen. And every morning, we sang God Save the Queen. We had drummers outside and we marched into school. And now, Melbourne here had all the Victorian post offices, the botanical gardens, all the streets are named after places in England. That's how much and close we are because we're part of the Commonwealth. And then in 1966, we went from pounds, shillings and pence to decimal currency. But I say, Andrew, the UK is in our blood. You know that.
We're talking about a lot of blood on this show.
We are, aren't we? Oh, my God.
It's a horror show, isn't it? And just for Friday the 13th, it's in your blood. It's going to be good. Well, the other thing you've
it's
done...
It's in your DNA, you know. No, but all these things that you're so interested in so much, and you're a life observer, and you just, like, absorb everything, Andrew. But I just wonder, you know, I mean, you're an astute businessman, but the thing is, how on earth... You wear all these hats. How on earth... Do you physically manage all this? And you manage so much in so many companies. And how do you keep tabs on everything? I was just like, make me dizzy.
Really, I'll tell you what the secret is, Sabine. It really is very, very easy. They always say, if you do what you love, you'll never do a day's work in your life.
Yeah, that's true.
And I surround myself with brilliant people. I only work with the people who I really get on well with. I mean, it's such a fantastic journey. But everything I do is to do with entertainment. It's other people's legacy.
It's all linked. So, it's all
exactly. Yeah. So and I do everything from the creation of ideas. We have a company called Boxer Tricks and some great creatives there. And they were the people who came up with Who Wants to Be a Millionaire? They worked for Celador at the time.
That's right, so
David Briggs and Coleman Hutchinson and various others as well, Mike Whitehill and Steve Springford and John Goff and myself. And we also combined forces with Fintan Coyle, who was the creator of something called The Weakest Link, which That's was awesome, sold to many countries around the world. And so we're doing lots of game shows there. But I'm also working with lots of companies coming up with new intellectual property ideas. So whether it's new characters for licensing and so on and so forth. So I helped take Peter Rabbit, for example, to Japan a number of years ago.
Wow.
Working for a company. Brilliant stuff. So we took Peter Rabbit to Japan. And what a lovely meal that was.
Oh, it
was
good.
Now I've got to say what Vivian said, right?
I don't know. No animals were harmed in this show.
They were. There's a lot of blood and gore. This is the different show. This is the R-rated Plastic EP.
All right, let's read this out. Well, I say Sir Andrew gets everywhere. He is an amazing man, very talented. Glad he is on your show. Look at this.
Oh, thanks, Viv.
Read that one. He's a robot, really.
Oh, is he?
I am a robot. It's true. There you go. Fantastic. Well,
and so,
a big shout out to Viv, because every post, every platform that I go on, more platforms than Paddington, Viv is always there, and she writes some brilliant poems. And talking of the book, Viv actually wrote something in this book as well. I included in the back. There are little quotes from all sorts of people, from people from Charles Spencer, who's been on the show, Harvey Goldsmith.
Charles Spencer, I have to meet him.
Wonderful, wonderful people. And Viv also...
Andy, from Modern Romance. I know Andy.
Oh, you know Andy as well? So Modern Romance, And we love it. Sell. We're all there, aren't
that's
we?
It. That's the one.
He's so good. So he was on my show. I also did a show on something called Stellar TV, which I did with Mike.
Stellar TV, yeah.
And he came on there. And it was during pandemic, where we all had to be terribly creative. And we all, whilst doing all these fantastic Zoom things as well, I had the joy of having some studio shows. And because we had the wide open spaces, it was like my own personal concert. So I invited lots of friends to come along and perform live. And we had Andy came along and did Modern Romance. We had Clive Jackson, Doctor.
Oh, Doctor the Medics. He's a character. You know, the thing is that it's so every guest is from. They're all from different elements at different parts of showbiz, music, entertainment, comedy, magic, whatever. And that's the variety. That makes it so interesting. I love that. I mean, this is what I would like to do myself at some stage.
I've seen you on your social media things. You're 10cc, and you're the next time you're down with Soft Cell, and I love it.
You actually know. I think it was. Do you know my actor friend Clive Greenwood?
I'm pretty sure.
Yeah, you know Clive. You know, I have a lot of friends in the acting profession, and
do that line again. You cannot say I've a lot of friends in the acting profession.
What is it? Well, I've got lots of lovely friends.
Come on, do your best lovey voice, Sabine.
Oh, my lovey friends, darling.
I love you. I've got so many lovey friends. I love them all badly.
But this is the whole thing. So, you know, and then how did Octopus TV come about?
Look at you with your deep and penetrating questions. Very good. I'll tell you how it came about is I started life, as I say, as a lawyer. But more and more clients got me involved, not just behind the screen, but also on the screen. And they were looking at ways of helping develop their business. So I talked about Peter Rabbit. I also helped with Formula One in Japan. And it was at a stage where not all the rights had been licensed. And so we basically, talking to a Japanese company, Fuji Television, they were doing computer game rights. And they were looking for various other things. And we said, look, why don't we do computer game rights for Formula One? And at that stage, there were lots of pirates on the market and so on and so forth. You'd have Ayrton Henna as opposed to Ayrton Senna and all these funny little things. Great hairdo day. And so what happened is I negotiated alliance with Bernie Ecclestone at that stage on behalf of Fuji Television. And I said to them, rather than just get Japan, why don't we do a worldwide license? Because it's never been done before. And we'll mop up the market. We'll get rid of all the pirates. We'll license people officially and basically create what is now a multi-zillion dollar business. And I negotiated that with Bernie on behalf of Fuji. And they said to me, Andrew, look, we understand that's great. We understand Japan, but we don't understand the rest of the world. Could you therefore be our agent for selling the rights around the world? So that's what I did. And then more and more companies came to me and talked about, like, let's do live streaming. And I did some of the very first live streaming with the people like the FA. I helped Thomas Cook basically become a broadcaster. I did all of their videos. Having a channel on that sort of basis. And the reason I came up with the word octopus is firstly, I think it's a brilliant name because you've got everywhere.
I get it.
But in Japan, where it's all started, the number 8 is incredibly lucky. So that's what
you
do.
I know this.
It used to be can't say it anymore, but it used to be two fat babies, they used to say in
Bing. It has other meanings too, actually, but okay.
What are the other meanings?
No, we can't go there, not this show.
This is the blood and gore R-rated show.
You've got tentacles everywhere, all over the world, and that's why. Take my hat off to you. I admire the fact it's people like you and me and Sabine and certain people on the net every day that are champions of the world and they want to entertain people. That's what they want to do. They're motivated to make the world a happy place and make people in the world happy. And I got to take my hat off to you because I've noticed that you're one of these rare champions, and I mean that sincerely.
That's for sure. Because the thing is, let's be honest about this. Like the last 2 and a bit years have been atrocious. You know, we know it's been hard for everybody, and you know, we had no gigs, we had no music, we had no shows, no concerts, no theatre, no opera, whatever, all shut down. You know, so you know the whole process, like bring it on the net. Let's bring it to the people, pour our passion into the shows and spread the love and everything else, you know, because people need escapism. People need to be lifted. And you know, this is what we're all doing. And I think we're doing a grand job, actually, Andrew.
I'm so proud of you. Over 700 episodes. I think it's absolutely brilliant. And
oh, that's plastic. I mean, I've only come along last year.
But what I would say is that people have been terribly creative. They've all started to reinvent themselves. And you have people like I mentioned Toya earlier, who does a brilliant
online
thing with our wonderful husband Robert
Fripp. Yeah, Robert Fripp. Yeah,
great show, great look out for that. But I also, if you might remember the Rolling Stones, they did a fantastic one where they had the four screens. And do you remember? And I think it was Charlie Watts was on the drums playing some saucepans or something. It was hilarious stuff. So what I think, whilst we have been in difficult times, and it's really important to talk about the difficult times, I always campaign for mental health. I established this canned laughter. And it's canned laughter. It's okay not to be okay. And what I try to do in my shows and the various people I talk to is get them to talk about their own experiences. Because it's Shakespeare who said, if you prick me, do I not bleed? If you tickle me, do I not laugh? And I think the reality is we're all the same. And you can be the most famous person in the world, the richest people, and a lot of them are chums. And we talk to them. They've got real issues as well.
Of course.
The more that people can talk about and we can shine a spotlight. I want us, this is my big campaign, I want us to be the generation that talks about mental health so the next generation don't suffer the stigma.
Yeah. Well, I actually have a friend who runs a mental health organization for the music industry, for artists and anyone associated with in any sphere in the music industry who you know, has been suffering from depression or you know, just you know. And so I'm going to promote it with her more, because she needs you know, another platform. So and you know, right, so Fred, they had a big double pace page spread in
I
love those guys. They've been on our show. I love those guys. They're going to come on again. And so, you know, this is so topical right now. And it's not just in the music industry, is it, though? I mean, it does. It's all around, you know.
What I love, I mean, the royal family, as we talked about Her Majesty the Queen earlier, and a fantastic 70th Platinum Jubilee, the wonderful celebrations of Her Majesty, 96 years young.
Yeah, incredible.
But also a lot of the royals themselves are doing great work, great ambassadors. They sometimes get a lot of bad press, but we deserve to get good press. Praise where praise is due. Both Harry and William have spoken out about, and Meghan has as well, spoken about the challenges of mental health. And this is what I really like, is that people in the public, I've also spoken to Right Said Fred, as you know, who've been very open about their own battles and the demons that they face. It's by those in the public eye who speak about it, it does give comfort. And if we can save one person as a result of just talking about it, so much the better. But big shout out to Harry for talking about his things. Big shout out to him.
Yeah. And I think Will and Kate are so hardworking. I haven't met them. I almost met them the other day at the rugby ground.
Yeah, they told me. They said that Sabine's coming around. Going to run.
I missed them by 20 minutes.
They were running faster. That's what happened.
They ran away, but no, they are so incredibly hardworking, and you know, I hats off to them. I mean, the younger royals now, I think, have to take on board more engagements. You know, the Queen, bless her, I mean, she's just marvelous, but you know, I think she needs to take a little bit of a rest now and just occasionally.
We saw her. I mean, there've been reports and worrying about her mobility and things like that.
Yeah. But
she was out just photographed very recently at the Windsor Horse Show. She adores her horses.
And she loves horses.
On her face was absolutely wonderful. And I've had the pleasure, as I say, a real honour of going to Buckingham Palace, and I've met the Queen and also the wonderful Prince Philip. Who was absolutely brilliant. I met them. I was at an event and I was introduced, and they said that first of all, the Her Majesty comes in and gets introduced every first, and they said, this is Andrew Eborn. He's a barrister and a magician. And and Her Majesty said, oh, how nice. And then sort of walked on. Philip, who was absolutely brilliant, who's the perfect warm-up guy ever.
His quips.
He was wandering around, and he got given the same introduction. This is Andrew Eborn. He's a barrister as well as a magician. And he took a couple of steps back, and he came back to me and said, I bet that's good for pulling the birds.
You know what? I have two books full of quips and these one-liners from the two. It was just absolutely amazing. I wish I'd met him.
Oh, no, but he was absent. So I said back to him, it's good for pulling the birds and also the rabbits as well. It's got to be good.
Brilliant.
But he was brilliant. And a lot of people, they do have these sort of one-liners. And he was the perfect companion to the Queen, because the Queen obviously maintained that wonderful regal presence. But he could go in there and basically work any crowd as the perfect warm-up man.
Oh, yes, we're going to have a street party. I mean, it's all our neighbours are going, you know, we've got bunting and all kinds of stuff.
In the bunting. Poor old bunting. Release bunting.
So it's all going on in our area, you know, during that
now, week. Andrew, I've got to ask you, you're doing this big book tour on your new book, as I said, and it must be fantastic now going out there and telling and signing the book.
Yeah, what about book signings?
How great is that?
Waterstones. Are you going to do that?
And we've talked about a lot of book signings and lecture tours and so on and so forth. And now that it's open, we're delighted to do all of that. What I also like, though, and it's what I like, a special event, rather than just book signings, I'm delighted where I get engaged, as you know, to do lots of shows around the world and to present things. I do a lot of work, as I say, with Japan. I was really honoured to be invited down to Cannes.
I noticed.
By TBS, to Tokyo Broadcasting System, who are the creators of Ninja Warriors. And they also created Takeshi's Castle. Like, brilliant format. And I helped introduce their new format, which is called Totally Outnumbered, which is all about, it's rather like Kill Bill. You have one person and they take on one expert against lots of other people. And they got me down there to host this sort of thing. But what? Every 5 minutes, my phone was going off. It was EP saying, have you done my trailer yet? Have you done my trailer for my 700th show? Every 5 minutes. And they were all scowling at me, the Japanese, and I had to do another take. I had to break
I'll tell you what, it all sounds like great fun to me. I mean, as you say, I mean, you love what you do, and the passion's clearly always there for everything. But, I mean, you're just like, you must have a permanent smile on your face, Andrew, because, I mean... I mean, everything you do.
It's got to be good.
I know something has to be serious.
Many hats. Now, Andrew, if you remember, I told you last time when you're driving through London, I told you about your favourite song at home. So I'm going to play that for you again so you can recall.
Okay.
1, 2, 3, 4. At home, all alone, no one to turn to, no one to turn to. At home, please stay with me. Hello, no one here with me. No one to turn to, no one to turn to, no one to turn to now. And I say, hey now, ooh now, what you gonna do now? Hey now, ooh now, you're feeling blue now. Hey now, ooh now, what you gonna do? What you gonna do? Without me, without me, without me, yeah. At home, what you by my side? Hello, don't run and hide. Come on and love me, come on and love me. And I'm all by myself in me, oh, oh. And I'm all by myself in me, oh, oh. Hello, won't you stay with me? No one to love me, no one to love me, no one to love me now. And I say, hey, na-na, ooh, na-na, what you gonna do? Na-na-na, hey, now, ooh, now, you're feeling blue now. Hey, now, ooh, now, what you gonna do? What you gonna do? You need me. All alone, no one to turn to, no one to turn to, no one to turn to now.
That was Plastic
Groovy. I really love that song,
but it's actually really sad. I mean, tell me the story behind it.
Hey, I put that out in 1981 at the peak of punk in Australia, yeah. And that was the first song that I recorded, Andrew. Then I went on to write another 2,400 songs. But let me tell you, I have this vision of you driving around in London with the windows open in your sports car and just go, hello.
But they're saying that's not true. You're driving around. I mean, that's just the thing. And there's a picture of you with Vicky and all this sort of stuff. You're not at home. All alone. They're very sad lyrics, you know?
No. But it's so punk. I love it.
It is wonderfully punk. But what was the inspiration? When punk was there. It's a great tune. Were you going through a lonely period at that time?
No, it just came to me. I just wanted something to sing about.
He just gets these ideas. He sits in the bathtub and gets an idea, you know?
It's basically a lie. I'm not at home at all, you know? This is like when we had lockdown. You see, you should play driving in your car. No, I'm at home. I'm not driving around at all. That's what you want. I'm all alone. I was like, socially distanced.
I like it so much, Plastic. I think you should re-release it.
Listen, Andrew, let me tell you, if you go to YouTube Music is free. Go to any platform you want, even the one you pay for. Download the song At Home by Plastic EP and the records or the EPs, it won't matter, and play it in your car when you're driving along in your sports Jag with your beautiful blonde next door to you, right?
Oh, dear. I didn't say it's a great, great idea. I love that very fact that people are not at home. I think they should do that. What you should do then to make sure that makes sense, when people are sitting at home on their sofa, you could have driving in my car. So you can make the reverse of it. So, I think we should turn the world on its head. This is the new campaign we're going to have.
The more you turn it up, the more they love it, and your neighbours love you more.
So can I just interject here? So, you know, we're talking about London now, and I miss, Andrew, is when I lived in London, so I'm in Twickers now. It's not suburbia, but, you know, it's outside. But the thing is that I used to love doing walks. And my actor friend Clive and I, we used to go on these walks. My actor friend.
Whenever you talk about your actor friends, if you just give them one word at the end, then we'll know what part.
It's not like that. You know, Clive, it's not like that.
Who was your friend?
Clive Greenwood.
What does he do for a living?
He's an actor.
That's very good.
Yeah,
not bad. Okay.
Well, anyway, as I was saying, we used to do these walks, and I've seen clips of you, you know, in Regent's Park and wherever you've been in London. And I'm an observer too, and I just absorb everything. I love the architecture. I love everything about London. I love taking an area that I don't normally go to and exploring, you know. But I've been doing memory lane trips because it's all for my memoirs, because I am actually writing my memoirs. And I've had a very eventful life so far. Anyway, and the thing, especially in the 80s. And so I'm doing all these memory lane things that I've been to Chiswick, where I was born, and Southfields and Basingstoke, which is not in London, of course, but it's all pertinent. It's all part of my memoirs. But I'm itching to do these London walks again. And Richard Porter is my friend who's the Beatles historian and tour guide. And he does all the Beatles tour walks. So I'm going to do that with him. And but I would like to do a walk with you one day. I would like to do a London thing, you know. So I just fancy that because I've seen those clips and they're great, you know.
I love walking around, and it did come a lot during lockdown, where rather than sort of sitting at home and doing Zoom or StreamYard or one of these other bits and pieces, yeah, I guess, well, we can do it. We'll walk around. We're allowed a bit of exercise, so I'll take people with me. And I live in one of the most beautiful cities in the world. Mm-hmm. And you bump into all sorts of things. At the moment, we've got the big debate about heating or eating, and times are tough, and you've got the squeeze. But there's a lot of stuff that you can do, which is free. And exercise is so good for your mental health.
Yeah.
I also got to say, you and Andrew should get dressed up and go and pull indicates, the swinging 60s.
Oh, drive. Yeah, Paul's great.
I went on the very first bus. The very first time he did it.
What, in Richmond or London?
John Fiddler. Who's a medicine head. Do you know John Fiddler?
Yes.
So he invited me along to pull the inaugural bus, and there's pictures of going. Check out the first video. You'll see me there somewhere.
I'll have to look at that, Andrew, because I did the Richmond one, because being over this side of town, Paul, you know, I won tickets through the Richmond Twickenham Times.
Oh, well done.
But I've yet to do the London one. And then now with the Rolling Stones being in Hyde Park in July, then there's a special gig at the 100 Club, which all ties in with Paul's event and everything. So got to do that. So we're hoping to do something, aren't we, Plastic? We're going to, like, do something like a live link or something. The bus thing, got to do that again, because people, like, you know, musicians, artists, you know, they go in the bus, and like Steve Hackett or whoever it is, Mick Avery, it's fun.
They're coming live from the tour. The
it's
360s tour, and they've got the special one now, the Stones at 60.
Yeah,
amazing. Yeah, but I'm just thinking now, because I'm one of these people that, like Mike, come up with loads and loads of ideas all the time. I just, ideas come, you know, 3 o'clock in the morning, I wake up and think, I've got to write that down, you know. It may be nothing, maybe something, you know, but it's there. But so I'm thinking now with the mental health issue and things that we're talking about now and the bus, I'm thinking could merge the two. It doesn't always have to be music. It can be music as well. But I think with the mental health thing, you know, to make it appealing and interesting to people, tours, you know, I don't know. There's something there.
Definitely something there. And we can have on the bus, we can have blaring out of the speakers. We're driving along. I'm at home. And we can,
we can work
on that basis.
Yeah, but not only that, I think you'd get a lot of music people supporting you, right?
You will.
Well, yeah, because, as I said, my friend is running this business, and, you know, she's helping a lot of musicians in the industry, because it's there. They are also, a lot of them are suffering. Yeah. And even pre-pandemic. We're not just talking about
that. You're absolutely right. And what you find is sometimes the most outspoken people, the most outrageous, the biggest extroverts on stage, the ones who suffer the most. You find that with comedians.
Oh, absolutely.
As well. So,
Tony Hancock, remember?
Comedians. Yeah. They have big struggling issues. And I think that's why I say people should talk about it and have a look at that sort of side.
Yeah, it really is. It's something that we really have to go into now, because it's so important. But, you know, with all this, you know, the entertainment aspect, you know, it all will gel. It will help, you know, and people need to be lifted. And, you know, this is why I think music, comedy, you know, love, like all these like upbeat, positive things.
MCL. Music, comedy, and love. The MCL coming.
Let's promote it. I know. We've got to promote these things. You know, it's so important for all of us. You know, even those who don't suffer from depression. Now, there's still we all have down days. You know, we're human. It happens.
And this is what I love about this show and the shows that you do and various others as well, is that people, anytime you're feeling down, come and watch this bit again, because it's so important, because you will find the great things. You will find some help from others talking about their issues as well. So the great thing, this is out there forever.
It's good to highlight these things. It's absolutely good to highlight things and promote things. You know, it's all positive. It's all good, you know, and this is what we help. We help each other. And this is how it works, you know. So what's the next thing, Andrew? Is there anything else on the agenda that we don't know about? Yeah, is there anything else?
In a moment, we're pre-production on several new shows and series for some quite major broadcasters, which it was quite fun. And I'm doing the regular thing. I was on TV again at the weekend doing the breakfast show, which is always lovely. And what I love about that, and I said to you earlier, I surround myself with my friends. A lot of the people that I'm working with now, I grew up with. People like Anne Diamond used to be on CBAM. Yeah. So an absolute delight. Steve Dixon from Sky. You've got Eamon Holmes and
Eamon.
Eamon's lovely. And you get all these sort of people. And it's such a happy family. I mean, it's working. There's a great a show on Apple Plus called The Morning Show. With Jennifer Aniston. I don't know if you've seen it, but it's all about doing a breakfast TV show and all the shenanigans and other bits and pieces. And it's true. It's true. I just love it. There's a wonderful energy about it. So I'm involved with lots of projects. We've got lots of things in pre-production. Some of these things go on for ages. And I always say with lots of people, you've got to have many horses running because some of them will then come home.
Yeah.
I'm also working with lots of a fantastic Italian artist who was a big star in Italy beforehand called Mauro Repetto. And I'm working with him with Warren Campbell, who's over in Canada. And what we're doing there is launching. It's a new style of music. I'll share. You can play it on the show. It's some brilliant.
But whatever happened to Sabrina?
So Sabrina's fantastic. We love all that sort of stuff. You love Sabrina. Sabine and Sabrina, that's what we're doing.
You've got a cover of her single somewhere, but I just always remember her. Boys. So I'd like to find out where is she? Let's bring her on the show.
I like the idea of where are they now. I do like
Me too.
Because you can shop with people and find out what's happening. Because often we talk about it's a flash in the pan. I mean, this is such a funny business, this business we call show.
Yeah.
You know some actors, don't you? It's a flash in the pan. We're paying. Everybody now is getting their 15 minutes. And the difficulty is this. You have to do it with a sense of humour. Don't believe your own publicity. Don't believe your own.
That's so true.
People do that. And everyone's, when you're up there, they're all helping. They all want to be part of it.
And
it goes down, which it does for everybody. There'll be little dips and troughs and maybe carry on forever.
Yeah.
You'll go down at certain times. And then you're deserted. You're all alone. At home.
And you're only as good as your script and all that. Yeah, exactly. I love this. Where are you now? Or where are they now? I love that. And the names just pop in to mind, and you think, now whatever happened to,
You're absolutely right. Well, the other thing that I'm doing, apart from shining a spotlight on new talent as well, is we've got a few venues that I'm working with. We're supplying artists to that.
In the UK
in the UK, but also around the world.
Globally,
people with franchises. So what I do, I work with a lot of companies and help them internationally, help them expand their business as well.
Mm-hmm.
So I'm working with a company there. We're putting on lots of live events. I'll send you details of those.
You're such a busy bee, Andrew. Honestly, I I'm a multitasker, and I think I can do, but I get distracted too, and I think I never get certain things off the ground because something else comes along and I think, so I better go and focus on that. The hardest thing I think is focusing and being disciplined and thinking like, what is priority now, but you're just wearing so many hats and doing, you're into so, you, your fingers are in so many pies. I just marvel at
that. I own the pie factory, it does help.
You are an octopus, you really are.
Now, Andrew, I want to say we want to congratulate you again on your book and the fact that you've gone around and toured. And we want everyone to go to eBay, and we'll put the link above there. It's a special offer for the Plastic EP show. Tell them about that one more time, Andrew, and also tell them about all your links at Octopus TV.
Absolutely. So do pop along to eBay. I've done a very special offer just for the Plastic EP show. If you go along there now, you'll get it at a bargain price. And because I will basically control that account, I can personalize them if you want them. So do drop me a note. It'd be lovely to hear from you. Go to eBay now, the Andrew Eborn Book of Failure, the second edition, with a foreword by Mike Reed. That's the one.
Do
get your copy now. You can also, if you can follow me on Twitter, at Andrew Eborn, and also at Octopus TV, it would be an absolute delight to hear from your people, because your people are brilliant. You've got a fantastic audience.
Thank you. Thanks for your time. I really appreciate it, because you are so busy bee.
I'll tell you what, before you go, we can try it. Are you up for an experiment?
Oh, okay.
Okay, I want you, both of you, we'll get both of you, we haven't planned anything beforehand. A little experiment over here. What I want you to do is, Sabine, give me a colour. Do you want red or black?
Red.
Okay, red would be hearts or diamonds, plastic.
Do I go for black?
No, you've got red.
I've chosen red, you've got to choose.
Decide amongst yourselves. You can change your mind if you want. Did you want red or black?
Red. Yeah.
I'll go for black.
Sabine wants red. You can pick hearts or diamonds, plastic.
Diamonds.
Hearts or diamonds. Diamonds.
Okay, hearts or diamonds. Okay, diamonds. Do you want high or low, Sabine?
High.
high, okay? So a high number. Do you want odd or even high number? Plastic.
Even.
Even high number. Okay, so you've got diamonds, even high number. What's an even high number? Give me the card. Even high number, Sabine.
10.
10. Okay, let's have a look. We have here a pack of cards. Where are we?
Oh, you're going to do magic, aren't you?
No, I'm not going to do magic. I'm going to show you something rather special. Here we go.
I love this.
Out here like this. Can you see those?
Yeah.
All the cards, all facing one way as we go through, all facing one way apart from one card.
Oh, my goodness. I don't believe this. Go on. Show us. Reveal.
You picked this. You could have picked any color at all. You picked red.
Yeah, red, diamonds, 10.
Plastic. Picked diamonds, you then picked high. We went backwards and forwards a little while, and a pack of we didn't organize this beforehand. This would be a miracle if it worked. But if you have a look over here, the 10 of diamonds,
that's incredible. I tell you what, I have a friend called Dave Davis, he's not
and
the king.
Round of applause, throw money.
Yeah, no, absolutely. Bravo. I don't know how you do it. I don't know how you do it. Is that true?
You don't know why I do it. I think it's probably.
No, that's incredible, Andrew. I as I say, I've got a friend called Dave Davis, and he's been on, I think he's on YouTube, and he's an amazing magician, and he has actually shown me in the pub right before, and I just, the sleight of hand is just so quick, but he's had an audience in the pub the other day. People were just like incredulous.
It's one of, and there's a real art.
Well done.
Really love about it. And the shout out to the Magic Circle, which was founded in 1905. I'm a member of that. I have been for a number of years. And we have, I helped them organize a blue plaque with my good friend Mike Reed.
Yes, I saw that video. Yeah.
And and that's on Wardour Street. So you can have, and we've got Dynamo.
Never been there.
Open it. Go and have a look. It's on Wardour Street. Again, one of the free things.
Yeah, but they wouldn't let me in, would they? They wouldn't let me in.
Oh, I'm not the Magic Circle. No, we do have special days where you can have guests.
Please tell me. Then I'm going to be there.
Absolutely.
Would you invite me, Andrew? No,
I'm always invited. It's absolutely brilliant. And I'm going to come down to Australia as well, because I love Australia.
Okay, brilliant.
I should also give a shout out to Sheldon Riley as well, who I thought was brilliant on Not the Same on Eurovision. And what I also love is stretching that definition of Europe to include Australia. Well done.
Yeah.
It's very good. That was lots of fun.
Yeah. Thank you so much for your time, Andrew.
With your time, Lord I just want to say, it's always a pleasure. Don't wait. Check out the links above. And Andrew, we thank you. There you go. The Book of Failure. You can't go wrong.
It's an absolute delight. Thank you so much, Sabine Plastic. It's a real pleasure. I look forward to catching up with you both very, very soon.
Thank you, Andrew.
See everybody.
Take care. Bye.